An ectopic pregnancy is a relatively rare but serious complication of early pregnancy. If you want to learn all about ectopic pregnancy, watch this video. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist helping people build families for almost 20 years. And a lot of my work is diagnosing and treating ectopic pregnancy if it happens. Again, it's relatively rare, but it's something that you've got to diagnose soon in order to take care of the pregnant person because it can have serious complications. And so in this video, you're going to learn a lot, an overview of ectopic pregnancy. We're going to cover five main topics. Number one, we're going to cover exactly what an ectopic pregnancy is. Number two, we're going to cover how common ectopic pregnancy is. Topic number three, we're going to cover risk factors. Who is at risk of getting an ectopic pregnancy? Number four, we're going to go over how to diagnose an ectopic pregnancy. This can be tricky because it's so early, but you've got to understand how you can make sure you have the right diagnosis. And finally, topic number five, we're going to go over how to treat an ectopic pregnancy. There are options and there's pros and cons to both. So at the end of this video, you're going to understand a lot about ectopic pregnancy. Let's get started. Topic number one, what is an ectopic pregnancy? Easiest way to explain it is it's a pregnancy that implants outside the uterine cavity. You're supposed to have a pregnancy inside the uterus, but sometimes this goes wrong and can be implanted outside. Let me remind you a little bit about how pregnancy works and how it usually happens. So typically an egg ovulates from the ovary out here, goes into the fallopian tube, and this is where it waits to meet sperm. Sperm comes up through the uterine cavity, egg and sperm meet in the fallopian tube, and that fertilized egg, which is now called an embryo, comes down through the fallopian tube and it implants inside the uterine cavity. This is where a pregnancy is supposed to implant. If it implants anywhere outside of that uterine cavity, so in the fallopian tube, on the ovary, or even sometimes outside of the uterus and reproductive organs and in the abdomen, that is an ectopic pregnancy. As far as location, 95% of ectopic pregnancies will be in the fallopian tube. About 3% will be found on the ovary itself, and the rest can be found throughout the abdomen within the pelvis. So how can this happen? Well, we went over how normally eggs and sperm find each other in the tube. So if the pregnancy implants in that tube, that can explain how ectopic pregnancy happens. Now, remember that the egg ovulates from the ovary out here, so it could fertilize with the sperm out in the abdomen and implant on top of the ovary, or maybe implant just out in the abdomen and pelvis. It's very, very rare, but it can happen. Or maybe the egg and sperm do meet in the fallopian tube, but the embryo goes backwards and implants here on the ovary or out into the pelvis. Again, ectopic pregnancies are rare, but this is how we think it can happen. So topic number two, how common is ectopic pregnancy? 2% of pregnancies will result in ectopic pregnancy. That's how common, 2%. Topic number three, risk factors for ectopic pregnancy. There's really six that we think of. Number one risk is a history of an ectopic pregnancy. So if you've had an ectopic pregnancy in the past, it's been treated, and you're pregnant again, there's a 10 to 20% chance that that second pregnancy is an ectopic pregnancy. So drastically higher risk of having another ectopic pregnancy if you've never had one in the past. Risk factor number two, a history of pelvic infection or surgery that could result in adhesions disrupting the tubal function. So abdominal surgery, a ruptured appendix, a history of pelvic inflammatory disease, anything like that in which the body heals with scar tissue around the tube could result with an increased risk of ectopic pregnancy. Risk factor number three, a history of infertility and especially endometriosis. Now I have a whole video here on endometriosis that you can learn about this common inflammatory chronic condition, but if you have endometriosis, it could affect tubal function, may impact risk of scar tissue in the pelvis and really impact the function and ability of the embryo to come into the uterine cavity. So not everyone with endometriosis is going to have an ectopic pregnancy. I'm just saying these are some things that we think about when we're thinking about risk factors. Risk factor number four is actually treatment with in vitro fertilization. So it was more common when we were doing a lot more fresh embryo transfers. Now that we're doing frozen embryo transfers, when the body is quiet and recovered from the stimulation, there's actually fewer ectopic pregnancies. But just treatment with in vitro fertilization, whether it is a baseline risk because maybe it was tubal function that was a part of difficulty getting pregnant, or something with the IVF process itself, it is a slightly higher risk of having an ectopic pregnancy, even if you do IVF. And I know that that can be mind-boggling for anybody who does IVF, and you realize that in IVF, we actually are placing the embryo into the uterine cavity up through the cervix. So we're placing the embryo into the uterine cavity, and you would think, how can an embryo get from the uterine cavity out into the fallopian tube or even beyond? But it can happen. Risk factor number 5, a history of smoking and tobacco use. It impacts tubal function. And finally, risk factor number 6 is age 35 or older for the pregnant person. Topic number 4, diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy. Now, this should be straightforward and easy. It's either in the uterus or it's in the fallopian tube or somewhere else, but this is actually pretty tricky. You can combine using blood tests for pregnancy hormone, transvaginal ultrasound, time, risk factors, looking at the clinical picture, symptoms like spotting, bleeding, pain, all of this can come into play when you're trying to help figure out where the pregnancy is. I know it seems crazy with how much technology we have these days, but really early on, the pregnancy is so small, sometimes you can't see it, and it really takes time to figure out what's going on. So you can know you're pregnant with a positive pregnancy test at home or a blood test in the lab, but until you see an intrauterine pregnancy within the uterine cavity on transvaginal ultrasound, you can't be 100% sure that the pregnancy is where it's supposed to be. And that doesn't usually happen until at least 6 weeks gestation, which is about 2 weeks after a positive pregnancy test. So there can really be some limbo in there where you're doing multiple blood tests or you're doing ultrasounds with your doctor and you're trying to figure out exactly where the pregnancy is. But a combination of the blood tests with the pregnancy hormone, vaginal ultrasound to get visualization, risk factors, symptoms like spotting and pain, and just your whole clinical picture can really help you and your doctor figure out exactly where that pregnancy is. Get really confused and frustrated when the doctor doesn't know for sure. And it can be so hard. People say to me, why can't you tell? Like, here's an ultrasound. Where is the pregnancy? Is it in the uterus? Is it in the, you know, ovary? Is it in the fallopian tube? And sometimes it is just so small that it's really, really hard to see. And you have to do some serial ultrasound and blood work in order to figure out exactly what's going on. Because especially if this is a precious pregnancy, you know, for my patients that have done fertility treatment and the biggest thing that they want in the world is to be pregnant with that child that they've been waiting for. You do not want to get this wrong. You want to keep your patient safe because an early diagnosis will decrease the risk of bleeding or need for surgical intervention in an urgent fashion. But you also want to be really, really sure that you've got the right diagnosis because it's such a highly desired pregnancy. So topic number 5, what about treatment? When you know that it's an ectopic pregnancy, what can you do? There's either medical treatment or surgical treatment for an ectopic pregnancy. Sometimes you don't have an option. If someone is already bleeding from a ruptured ectopic pregnancy in the fallopian tube, they need to go to surgery in order to resolve the pregnancy, stop the bleeding, and save the pregnant person's life. So if that's an urgent situation, you have to go to surgery. It's typically a laparoscopic surgery with small incisions, one in the belly button for a camera and 2 other small incisions lower in the pelvis for instruments that you can place in order to manage, find the pregnancy, remove it, stop the bleeding, etc. So it's typically low invasive surgery, laparoscopic. But if the ectopic pregnancy has been diagnosed and the pregnant person is stable, the woman is stable, she's not bleeding, you know that it's not in the uterus, maybe you can see it on the ultrasound or you've been following those blood levels really closely, you know where she is in her pregnancy and there is no pregnancy in the uterus, you can usually talk about doing medical treatment with a medication called methotrexate or surgical treatment with a laparoscopy that I just described. There's pros and cons to both. The medical treatment with methotrexate, it's typically a one-time shot of a chemotherapeutic drug. Methotrexate is used to treat a lot of cancers that are fast-growing cells. And so it's typically one shot, and it stops the development of those fast-growing pregnancy cells so that you can stop the development before the pregnancy causes the bleeding and the rupture within the fallopian tube. The pros of doing medical treatment or using methotrexate is that you're avoiding surgery. It can be done typically pretty quickly. In our clinic in Seattle, Washington, we actually are able to give it in our clinic. I know that's not the case everywhere around the country these days, but we can really treat someone quickly, which can be really helpful to decreasing the urgent situation that can come up later. The downside of doing the medical treatment is it does take a lot of follow-up. So you need to have serial blood tests to make sure that that pregnancy hormone level, the beta HCG, is dropping, and really follow very closely. So if it's not resolving, somebody can sometimes need a second shot of methotrexate. And then, just so you know, sometimes the methotrexate doesn't work and people can actually still have that tube rupture and need surgery anyway. But with close following and careful care with your doctor and your clinical team, it's something to consider. The pros of a surgical intervention are, of course, it can be necessary if somebody is already bleeding from their ectopic pregnancy. It needs to be done in an urgent fashion to help save that woman's life. But in a non-urgent situation, it can allow for quick resolution. You can either do a salpingostomy, in which you just open up the fallopian tube and take the pregnancy out, but leave the tube in place, or you can do a salpingectomy, where you just remove the entire fallopian tube. Now, there are pros and cons to both of those interventions, but it's a laparoscopic surgery. There usually is, of course, some follow-up. You'd want to follow what the pathologist sees, like make sure that really it really was pregnancy tissue that was removed. You might want to do the hormone blood test afterwards to make sure it's resolving, but it's not usually as many visits and follow-ups and blood draws as with the methotrexate or the medical intervention. But the cons are it is surgery, so it, you know, there's always risks with surgery, and there's time off of work, and there's risks that can happen, of course, with any surgical intervention. I want to end the video with a really important message. If you are watching this video because you are being followed closely for a possible ectopic pregnancy, or you've been diagnosed with an ectopic pregnancy, I need you to hear this. This ectopic pregnancy was not your fault. You did nothing wrong. Even if you have any of those risk factors that we talked about earlier in the video, that doesn't matter. That still, it might not be the actual reason. And even if you've had those risk factors, it's still not your fault that that's where the pregnancy implanted. You did nothing wrong. You should realize that 50% of people that get diagnosed with an ectopic pregnancy don't have any of those risk factors. Most of the time, we don't know exactly why it happened. But I want you to know it is absolutely not your fault. You did nothing wrong. And I want you to pay attention to the emotional healing and the mental health strain that getting diagnosed with an ectopic pregnancy can bring. A lot of times the doctors are focusing on keeping you safe, making sure, you know, you recover well, and they're thinking about the medical and the physical recovery of an ectopic pregnancy. And we sometimes forget to think about how emotional it can be, especially if this was a highly desired pregnancy, and you, even if you did fertility treatment or not, you just really wanted this baby. And a lot of times people, I think, get, you know, compassion and caring when it's a miscarriage, but something about an ectopic pregnancy, just sometimes people just don't know what to say. So I am here to tell you it is not your fault. You did nothing wrong. And please seek guidance, seek support for your mental health if this has really been a difficult process for you. It's grieving. It's loss. It's lost time. And if it happened to you, I'm so very sorry. But please realize, just because you had one ectopic pregnancy, it does not mean it's going to happen again. And again, it was not your fault. Thank you for listening to that. I really hope you learned something from this video. Like this video if you learned something. Comment with questions that you have. Be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And as always, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.